this is Michael Buffer, and let's get ready for KnockOut TV.
Welcome to this week's episode of KnockOut TV. I'm Tim Pileski. We're going to step outside the ropes, outside the ring tonight. We've got a special guest tonight in the studio here. I'm going to give you a little hint. That's right. Johnny Sacks, Vince Curatola, here tonight in the studio. Answers every question you have about Sopranos. I'm going to ask him a lot of questions. We're going to talk about the final episode, get his idea of what happened to Tony. Was he killed? Stick around, you're going to find out. You're watching KnockOut TV. Vince Curatola from The Sopranos, here next, right here on KnockOut TV.
You know, it wasn't long ago I remember you used to wait in the car. And as far as I'm concerned, you should still be there.
Wait.
How's the real estate business?
Excuse me?
You know, HUD, Garside Street, you, Ralph, Zellman.
Zellman tell you this?
No, Carmine doesn't know anything about this yet, Tony. I'm giving you an opportunity to cut a deal, make it right.
Last time, Freeland Heisen Avenue, I cut you in at a friendship. But that's over, John. You got nothing coming to you. You or Carmine.
You sure you want to go down this road, Tony? What do I got to lose, Jen? What's the difference?
You told
my mother.
Grandma?
This week's episode of KnockOut TV, I'm Tim Pileski. Got a special guest, Vince Curatola.
Hello.
Hello, Vince.
How are you?
I'm great.
It's good to be here.
Good to see you. Johnny Sack from The Sopranos. How you feeling?
I'm all right. I'm better than I was.
Yeah.
I'm alive.
Look a lot better. You look so much better.
I have more color in my face.
You
now,
do.
I think.
Your hair grew in a little bit. It looks great.
Well, I have a good hairdresser. I really
do.
Yeah.
We'll talk about that.
If you need them, I'll sure.
Okay.
All right.
Now, how was it dying? I mean, you didn't get taken out like the normal Soprano people do get taken out.
Johnny Sack was never normal. He was never normal. He never did the stuff that Tony did, that the rest of them did. You never saw him in a hot tub with women. You never saw him gambling. You never saw him. So it's not, it's not unusual that his death would be different than some of the other. Don't forget he's a boss, though.
That's true.
You know, so not getting killed is a big thing for a boss. And I think they gave Johnny the respect that he deserved by showing that you came full circle. You had him die being surrounded by his family.
True.
And so I think that was a very gracious ending for a very powerful man.
That was a powerful scene, too. Now, you prepared heavily for that scene.
Yeah, yeah. I have the privilege of being on the board of trustees of Hackensack University Medical Center. And that gives me all kinds of access to almost any room in the house.
Wow.
And I observed. But I did calculate that in my mind, terminal cancer would be something that where the battery just gets a little weaker and a little weaker and a little weaker and a little until everything just stops. And that's how I started. In fact, I died the first day we shot that episode.
Oh, you died first?
Yeah, I died first,
and
then for the rest of the
sicker?
3.5 weeks, got back to being, the diagnosis. So we went and reversed the entire schedule.
That was powerful.
So it was interesting. We had 6 makeup changes for, different parts of the day. Sometimes you had to change it 3 times in one day.
Wow.
But we have excellent artists, and they know exactly what they're doing.
They did a great job.
They
really
did.
Transformed
yeah,
you
they
into
did.
A,
they did.
An amazing dead person.
And I had
they
quit
really
smoking a month before I got the script for that episode. So the smoking had to be herbal cigarettes.
Also, they give you
phony cigarettes. I think they're tea or they're cabbage or something.
Really? How were you with that? I mean, did it bother you that you just...
I had to make believe that once I got to that bummed cigarette, that it would satisfy me. So I had to, in my head, say, okay, that's going to satisfy me.
Oh, yeah, that's good.
Otherwise,
yeah,
it would
go
be
back.
For nothing. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Now, how did you get the part for The Sopranos? How did it all start?
I was doing, in 1998, I was doing an NBC movie of the week with Chris Noth called Exiled.
Okay.
Where he got exiled from Law and Order into a precinct in Staten Island. And I had a small part because the writer brought me in on it. And my agent called me and said, there's this thing called The Sopranos, which we had already heard about.
Right.
They were shooting about to begin production on their sixth episode, first season. Hadn't aired yet.
Okay.
And I said, you know, all right, I'll go. I don't want to. That day we were shooting in Staten Island on this other thing. And I was tired. I had to run home and to New Jersey and get ready and go back to Manhattan for this audition. And I got there late. I got out of the cab,
right.
Decided to smoke a cigarette. I knew I was late. I was on West 72nd Street. Started walking around, saw some puppies in the pet shop, saw this, saw that. Put the cigarette out, lit another one. That took another 10 minutes, five minutes.
Anxious to get that rolling.
Yeah,
so.
I couldn't wait to run upstairs.
Nice.
Finally got upstairs about 25 minutes late. I walk in the room, big room, a woman is at a desk in the middle of the room, the head is down, all kinds of papers all around. Doesn't look up, says, you know, you're late, I'm sorry, I'm leaving, I'm going home. Okay, fine, no problem.
Yeah.
She looks up at me and she says, do you have the pages they faxed to you for these two scenes? I said, yeah. She said, okay, let's read them together. And then they introduced me to David Chase about 4 days later at Silver Cup Studio. I didn't know who he was either. And they gave me the role of Johnny Sack, which was only for that episode. I didn't hear from them for 11 months later until they got the pickup from HBO and decided to start to build this New York mobster. And then I went through the whole run.
Unbelievable.
Yeah.
Unbelievable. Now, we talked a little bit. I mean, we are a boxing show.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, KnockOut TV, we are a boxing show.
Mm-hmm.
You told me you had the opportunity that Muhammad Ali actually came on.
Yeah, he came on set.
That's great.
About a year. Well, no, a little over a year ago. He came on set with his daughter,
Layla.
He was at the invitation of Michael Imperioli, who's a dear friend of mine, who plays Christopher. And he came. I really didn't have much to do, but from what I understood, he stayed about 2 hours. They had to get clearance, by the way, from the office upstairs.
You mean
David
to bring
Chase.
Ali in?
Yeah, absolutely.
Unbelievable.
No, because it's like when you work with us, you work inside of a bank vault.
Okay.
They don't want any leaks. They have problems with leaks, which is their own fault.
Right.
But they're very. So he had to be, you know, you had to bring him to a certain set, and he can hear this, and he's not going to be able to hear that, especially his entourage. Not really him.
Right,
You're not trusting.
So he's some.
He can, people around him that could, you know, get on the phone with the Post.
And say, okay, you know, Tony's dead, Johnny's dead.
Right, exactly. Tony's really a transvestite.
Yeah.
You'll see
it. Yeah, I heard that rumor,
four,
too. I talked to Ali. He told me that.
But as far as boxers, let's see.
We spoke before. I'm sorry. Vito Antifermo was on the show.
I think it was season two. He played a carding. Well, he was collecting money from a carding company.
He was a good collector.
Very interesting guy. My grandmother almost married Jimmy Braddock.
Really? The North Cinderella Bergen. Man?
Yeah, exactly right.
What do you mean almost married?
She was like this close to being engaged. They had, you know, in those days they called it seeing each other. But my grandfather came along, very sweet man, and they married instead. So that's my claim to boxing.
Thing. So your grandfather stole your grandmother away from James Braddock.
I would say. My grandfather at least could count and speak and read and write. You know, that's a big thing in those days.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Very intelligent man.
Now going back, now you mentioned Ali and the secrecy. Now are you, is it in your contract? Are you sworn to secrecy?
Yeah.
You
no,
are?
Yeah, contractually, we could be sued. That would be breach of contract if we told you anything about what we're filming. So.
But now when you.
Because you tried that.
I have tried that.
You know, a few months ago when I met you.
Yeah.
I thought you were a dog for asking me that. But that's
not
a
show.
No, that
wasn't me. I never asked.
Taking advantage of.
I never
friendship.
Asked.
That's okay. Yeah.
But that's all right. I'm going to ask now, though.
ask now. What now?
Is Tony dead?
I think he's. You know what? I think he's dead.
Do you?
And I watched it with, it was on a couch, and
right.
Here's Jim Gandolfini, Tony Sirico, me,
okay.
Stevie Van Zandt, Steve Sciarippa plays Baccala, Michael
right.
Imperioli. We were put in this room in Florida after we had done a big appearance, and they let us watch it alone. And I say he's dead.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Now, we spoke before, and you told me that, now even you, Gandolfini,
mm-hmm.
had no idea the ending. Right?
No,
you watching it at 9 o'clock, like watching it at 9 o'clock, is the same exact thing.
It was the same
That's
thing.
That's amazing.
Yeah,
you
no,
guys have no clue.
We did a personal appearance in Hollywood, Florida at the Seminole Hard Rock, and I did a little over 9,000 people outside, and we had 800 inside that we had to do pictures with. and dinner and a private party they had us do for an hour and so on and so forth. But at 5 to 9, our business manager, Roger Haber, who travels with us, shut everything down. And they put us in a room, maybe triple his size.
Oh, so you're alone. Just the cast?
Just cast only.
Okay.
And we watch this. And, you know, we're sitting there like this. You know, and we're on the show.
Yeah.
And we've been on the show for a long time. What? Why? And one would look at the other and say, no, why did he cut it that way? Why did David edit this? So it was all a revelation. But if you noticed, when the camera came in, mm-hmm. it was really Jimmy's POV, Tony Soprano's POV. He's looking at an empty booth. Now he's looking here. Now he's looking there. Everything was his point of view.
Right.
The two guys who shot him, the two actors who shot him a couple of years ago, were sitting in a diner, as was someone else from his past.
And who was that?
Who crossed paths with him. That was the guy that was sitting at the camera.
Right.
Who, in season 5, near the end of season 5, was seen with some people who never had a good word to say about Tony Soprano. Now, is he a killer? We don't know. But
yeah.
I'll give you something else.
Okay.
If you look at Meadow trying to park the car and eventually mm-hmm. coming in that door.
Right.
If you looked at the distance between where the family was sitting in the booth and the distance of where the door is, they do what's called a smash cut. It's a hair second of him looking up. Meadow could never have gotten to his seat quickly enough for him to look straight up at someone. He'd be looking like this, wouldn't he? Gradually, as she's approaching, someone startled him, and he looked straight up, and then it went black, and I think he got killed. That's just me.
Will there be a movie?
No.
That's it?
No.
Sopranos is done.
Done. Done.
You heard it here first?
Oh, David.
This is, you know, because we got 10 viewers.
David Chase was asked this last week. He lives in France, and he said, you know, I never say never, but
yeah,
we know him, and there's not going to be a movie.
Yeah.
And I don't know what there would be a movie about at this point. I really don't.
Now, you also told me that they filmed, what, 3 different endings?
Yeah.
I mean, what were the other endings?
They were innocuous to the point where you would see him drive away in a car, which is stock footage.
Use that anywhere.
Yeah, you would see him falling asleep on his couch in his home and not breathing because they would stop motion. Maybe it was a heart attack.
Right.
So
okay.
They had ways of not having to film it. In other words, they would put in your mind that he's gone, he's dead. So.
Okay. Okay, so now Sopranos is done.
Mm-hmm.
Now, where does Vincent go now? What does Vincent do? I know you're busy. Now,
I go home. I bought hamburger patties today, and
I'm kind of hungry. Actually, we're all hungry.
I didn't ask you if you were hungry.
We're all hungry, but you know.
And I don't care either.
Thanks a lot. This is the last time Vincent Curatola will be on KnockOut TV, but it's fun having him. Now, I know you mentioned Imperioli.
Yeah.
Christopher.
Mm-hmm.
Now, you teach a class.
Yes.
He owns a
acting studio. Yeah, he built a beautiful theater on West 29th Street, Manhattan. He and his wife, Victoria. In fact, it was featured in Architectural Digest. It's absolutely gorgeous. It's a gold jewel box theater. They do original work only, original plays only. There's one opening now with Sharon Angela, who plays Rosalie April.
Okay.
And the other actress is Angelica Thorne, whose mother was Geraldine Page, and her father's Rip Thorne. Very talented,
very nice.
Young actress.
Very nice.
In any event, there's an acting class that Sharon and Michael and I teach on Tuesday nights, depending upon who's available. It's a master acting class, and we have some extremely dedicated students. We have one woman who I want to say is in her early 40s, an Italian, who comes to class every Tuesday night in Manhattan, 11 o'clock, leaves the class, even if it's not over, to get on the bus and go home to Montreal.
Wow.
That's a dedicated acting
single?
Student.
Single woman?
Yeah. Yeah, you got a few Perfect. Hours?
Yeah. Unfortunately, that's another story to be told at another time. Now, you also write?
I wrote a movie called Dearly Beloved.
That won the Academy Award, didn't that movie?
No, it did. But it starred me and Michael Badalucco, who won the Emmy for The Practice. Tony Sirico plays Paulie Walnuts. And my wife, Maureen, was executive producer. I wrote it. It's about a funeral home in Brooklyn. It's hysterical. We didn't have any money. So it's a 30-minute, well, it was film, not tape. But okay. We actually shot it on film, and, you know, this is tape.
Okay. Yeah, well, you know, we won't be on the air.
You want
long.
A little, like, so, a, so you want like
we
a
won't
little,
be on the air. We can
like
show you every
towel.
Wednesday night
anybody
at
have
10.
A towel?
What's the name of your, am I getting a little shiny?
No, you know what, no, I'll tell you what I'll do. I'm going
to
give you a copy when I see you again.
I would love
to beloved.
See it.
I want it back, though, because I don't have money left. You could watch it, and maybe you want to put a little clip on your next show or something like that.
All right, we'll show that. You know, rumor also has it that you sing.
Yeah.
You sing?
It's a rumor.
Is it a rumor?
Yeah.
Because I didn't think it was true. There's no way that's true. Are you really a...
You make
you
me feel so young. You make me
like
feel
Tony
like
Clifton.
Spring has sprung. Every time I see you grin. Is that okay?
It's fantastic.
I'm going to sing this coming Saturday night at the Hilton in Las Vegas.
Are you really?
Yeah, with John Ventimiglia, who plays Artie Bucco. We have an orchestra, the Lon Bronson Orchestra, who comes in from Vegas and
now,
accompanies us.
Is that something you'd like to do?
No.
I mean,
this
no,
is just
that,
something
that's just
we
something,
do. Yeah.
Like a little variety
it
act
is,
kind of a...
Yeah, we've done it all over. We've done it in Las Vegas at the Hilton on Elvis's stage. We sold it out. We've done about 9 or 10 of them. This one's a small one, this Saturday night. And once in a while, I get on the stage with the band Chicago.
How was that? That
Jones
must,
Beach.
That must be great.
And, yeah, it's wild.
That must be
it's
great.
It's amazing. 14,000 people. They sell it out to the max.
Do you have a singing background, or that's just something
I was,
you just
I was,
enjoy?
No, I was in a group when I was a teen. I was in a very big group, as a matter of fact, when I was a teenager.
What, did you have 15, 20 people in
it? No, I think it was 8 or 9. Hammond, you know, horns. I was
really
was a good size. They had to hide me. I was tall. I was 16, 15. You had to be 18 to play where they had liquor. They had to hide me. I had no, what they called an ABC card, blah, blah, blah.
Were you just a singer, or were you a musician?
No, I
also?
Played bass.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah.
That's fantastic.
Yep. I played bass. I enjoyed it.
That's,
really did.
That sounds like fun.
Acting is better. It's less work.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Now, you started a little late in life acting.
Yeah, I was...
Now, your wife got you into acting? Is that...
My wife always...
She was the influence?
Always encouraged me.
That's
to,
very nice. That's a great
But I was always too
thing.
Pragmatic, making a living, saying, you know, be what, and make $12 a year as an actor, you know? Because that's what happens. Didn't happen to me, it happens to a lot of people. But I always had a passion for the work. I always felt that. Because my favorites were Edward G. Robinson, Frederick March, Boris Karloff, and I got
oh,
to meet
yeah?
his
yeah,
very
yeah.
sweet daughter, Sarah.
That's fantastic.
I've gotten to meet a lot. One of the biggest moments has been a few years back. We were in a restaurant, Elaine's in Manhattan, and we spend a lot of time. And someone introduced me to Kirk Douglas, who was having dinner with his wife.
Didn't know you?
And he came, you know, he's had the stroke.
That's great.
And he grabbed my hand and he went, Sopranos, and, you know, you go home with the hand like this. Like,
did you watch it?
You know, did this hand touch Ava Gardner? Did this hand sign a contract with Louis
exactly.
B. Mayer? You know,
that's great stuff. Kirk
it's wild to think that they watched. Richard Dreyfuss gave me a great compliment. It's just, you feel like you're working sometimes, I don't know, in a vacuum. That people don't really watch, you know, the work.
Sure, sure.
It's amazing. And then, you know, we did something yesterday with Bill and Hillary Clinton.
Yeah, yeah, tell me about that.
She calls me John. I don't know how happy
well,
I
that,
am
that,
about this, but you she calls me Johnny. It's okay.
You've called me Tony, so we're...
Yeah,
you know, we're,
that's true. It was funny because what we did was, it was a last-minute thing. My manager called me Saturday night and said, they want one of the Soprano main cast to do something with Bill and Hillary Clinton tomorrow morning in Westchester.
Okay.
It's all right. What is it? So, blah, 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 we arranged it, we talked to everybody, and it was that Bill and Hillary are sitting in a diner in Mount Kisco.
Anything look good?
We have some great choices. I ordered for the table.
No onion rings?
I'm looking out for you. Where's Chelsea?
Parallel parking.
How's the campaign going?
Well, like you always say, focus on the good times.
So what's the winning song?
You'll see.
My money's on Smash Mouth. Everybody in America wants to know how it's going to end.
Ready?
The camera comes back to me. I'm drinking a cup of coffee. I get up. I want to go to the men's room, just like the guy. I go over. I give them this very, very cold, dirty look.
You got that down pat.
Thank you. I appreciate
you
it.
You do.
And I walk into the men's room. And they're flabbergasted because it's me. It's supposed to be on YouTube and her website and whatever else. And there's no title to it, but it was a lot. It was very hush-hush, as a matter of fact. That this was something I guess they decided to do off the cuff very quickly. And yeah, it should be good. It'll start up this week somewhere. So
that sounds like fun.
Which week are we in, according to your show?
This is our last show, so it doesn't really matter.
Your last show?
No, this is the beginning. This is the beginning.
This is the top of your schedule?
This is as good as it gets.
Oh.
This is as good as it gets. I got Kirk Douglas coming on next
week. Do you really? Say hello to him.
Yep.
By the way, he got my watch dirty when he grabbed my
arm. I
never said a word.
Is he that big of a man?
He's a big guy.
Yeah?
Yeah. He's 91 now.
That's
so
great.
He had to be like 87, 88 when I met him.
That's great. Now, you met the Clintons.
Yeah.
I mean, you met everybody.
Rudy Giuliani tells me that I am the true king of New York, not him. He's been telling me that for 3 or 4 years now.
Well, you got to drive home feeling good, though.
Yeah.
You know,
no, you do. You
that,
do.
That's really,
you
that's,
do. When people
know,
like that
really
go
nice.
Out of their way for you,
exactly.
Tremendous.
Exactly.
I appreciate
like you coming on here, I mean, I really do appreciate it.
Thank
it's
you.
Really nice to have you on.
It's nice to be. It's a Monday night. It's a slow night. And
well, it's Wednesday night. We're on Wednesday night.
Oh, yeah. Oh,
yeah,
it's Wednesday.
It.
Sorry. It's Wednesday. They're slow, too. So.
But it's been a pleasure having you on.
Thank
Vince.
You. We've really, done that, I mean.
I really appreciate
it. Right.
You want to talk more? We can talk
more.
No,
I'm good.
You're
I
hungry?
No, I'm all right. Thank
okay.
you. Yeah, I'm okay.
Okay. Thanks for watching this week's episode of KnockOut TV. I'm Tim Pileski. Thanks to my guest, Vincent Curatola.
Thank you.
Johnny Sack. Appreciate you coming on.
Anytime.
Vince, really appreciate it. Thanks so much.
Pleasure.